It's great to be here once again. You getting tired of the cold yet? I certainly am. I've never seen so many frosty, chilly mornings in California. It's cold all over. The whole planet is descending into a very, very chilly cold war, as it were. Today, just to get you up to date, it was an unbelievable day. So incredible. The most progress I've ever made in a day. I was able to tackle the most difficult areas seemingly with ease. And I just said, I was able to cover all the territory it needs to be covered. And I just said, it's doable. It's absolutely doable. For those who say, the ego will say it's not doable. The ego is lying. It's not true. It is doable. I was able to cover all the territory with ease. And therefore, I can do it. You can do it. We all can do it, absolutely. It is not too difficult at all. And then, of course, when you put on your social public persona to get through the day, that sort of like obscures it a little bit, of course. I understand that. But as far as when I look at it, able to look at it, absolutely. So I'm positive. It's absolutely certain that I'm up to the task of whatever is needed to do, and be able to look at the essential curriculum, what's important, and able to just see it, and it's easy for me. It's like when somebody really learns how to play the piano and they can play the song, and then at some point they say, "Well, this is easy for me." When they start out, maybe it's difficult. Once you get it, then it's easy. It's easy. I was able to look at all sorts of amazing difficulties that are holding us back, and I could look at them easily and resolve them easily, and understand the role that a teacher actually plays. I was able to see it and understand it and accept and say, yeah, it's easy. So the whole spectrum is become open to clarity, as I can see it, that clarity can see the entire spectrum of what needs to be seen, and able to know what is right, what is useful, and what is useless. All the differentiations are possible. The entire thing is possible. So, and then later on in the day, I was able to see the non-necessity of time, just the whole thing. I was like, right on the verge, you know, just of truly making the grade, absolutely making the grade. And then I even saw that almost isn't good enough, because how many almost moments can you have? Infinite. You can have infinite almost moments. And so you still have infinite moments of time. You just have infinite moments of almost time. Or almost made it. Almost no time. Infinite moments of almost no time. And that's just as bad as infinite moments of lots of time. There's still infinite moments of time. And what we're doing is saying, what if reality wasn't real right now? What if it wasn't real right now? So we're overlooking this eternal now, the overlay. This eternal now is here right now. We can either see this eternal now, or we see time. One of the two. And we can say, what we're saying is, what if the eternalness of reality wasn't true? What if it came to an end? What will we do then? So we're modeling that. But we, even in this modeling, we can still look at the eternal now. At probably what Eckhart Tolle is saying. You would think so. It would seem so. So anyway, he has his own style, which is fine. But there is this eternal now. And I can see it's a simple choice, a very simple choice. And we're capable of seeing through the defenses, seeing through the confusion. We're capable of just seeing it as it simply is. We're capable of doing it. Absolutely capable. I'm capable of doing it. I can say for sure I'm capable of doing it. I saw that today beyond a shadow of doubt. So... It's pretty simple, but it's not easy. It's the most difficult thing possible to, as it were, not see things. That doesn't mean you're seeing nothing. It's not quite like that. You're seeing the eternal now. You're seeing the eternal now. And all these forms are seen in that light, as it were. So the whole thing is understandable. It's all understandable. It's all can be clarified. So the challenge is there to be taken up and succeeded at. It really is. Because you can succeed. We all can succeed. Absolutely. All we have to do is try. That's it. Just try. And what do we have to lose? What do we have to lose? In the trying, we will certainly find that we're able to do way better than anyone thought. I mean, the ego is totally bluffing us. It's trying to say that we can't do it. That is not true. Not true at all. So it's super great news today. Super great news. It's as if the entire structure of defensiveness is just crumbling, and I realize I don't need any thoughts at all. I don't need thoughts. I don't need any I thoughts at all. I don't need the story of I at all. I'm kind of aware of the whole enlightenment picture of what's been said previously, and there's no need for any thoughts at all, because I thought is, well, what if nothing is permanent? What if there's just this impermanence here? What if there's this impermanence? What if these things weren't what they were? And so that puts time into the picture, because you can't see them as they are now. You don't need any thoughts at all to see now. Don't need any thoughts at all. So I just going through the whole thing and just unraveling the entire situation was being unraveled, which is a result of all the efforts and all the push, etc. So it's not easy, but it is simple. Just seeing how eccentric it is to try to introduce time at all. Completely eccentric. Utterly, completely whimsical and eccentric saying, but what if reality wasn't real? What if reality wouldn't last? So of course, when we're entertaining this idea, we're not seeing anything as it is. We're not seeing as it isness at all. We're saying, what if we could not experience as it isness? What if we could not experience that? So we're just simply pretending not to experience. So, and I just went about my day, and during the daytime, I had these profound insights. So many, I mean, just like really key core insights. So many today. And I saw, like, the flu was coming. Okay, I know people have had the flu this year, and really bad, really, really, really bad. I don't want to get it. Okay, I can't afford to. I can't afford to miss even a day of work. I think I've missed, like, in 8 years, I've maybe missed 2 days of work, and I literally cannot afford to miss a single day of work. I just cannot do it at all, and so I can't get the flu. I didn't get a flu shot. I don't get shots. One reason why, among many, that I can't travel and hardly anywhere is because I don't take shots. I won't get shots. I don't go in for immunization stuff and all that kind of stuff. No way. So I can't travel to all these places around the world, because you need various shots for a lot of places. I don't know about Europe or whatever, but a lot of places can't go. What kind of world is it where you can't even travel there? Otherwise, the only way you can travel there and not die is to get all this poison put in you. You know, it's just utterly bizarre place. Really, could you imagine reality being that way? it's just ridiculous. So I don't get a flu shot, and so of course you do think, wow. You're around all these people all the time, and they're all coughing. And you go to church, and people are just coughing like crazy. Speaking of going to church, my gosh, we had such a nerve-wracking time last Sunday. The service is going on, and we hear this horn, beep, beep, honk, 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 honk. And it gets louder and louder and louder, and then it comes right by the side of the church, and someone's just full blast on the horn the whole way and goes into the parking lot and everything. We're like, whoa, something weird is going on here. That is very unnerving. And then suddenly in through the doors, everybody's listening to the service, in through the front doors comes this guy. And he's holding a Bible in his hand like this, and he's holding a rosary here. And he walks in. Everybody's seated, paying attention to the priest. He walks in. He walks right in front of the altar and the priest and everything while the whole thing's going on. And then he walks to the side of the stage and just stands there like this, watching the priest like that. And we're all like, what in the heck is going on here? This is totally bizarre. And then he suddenly walks to the back by the baptism font and stands there rigidly like this, staring straight at the priest the whole time. And the whole congregation was getting nervous, and people were like looking like, what the hell's going on? You know, like that. It's like we were scared. Everybody was very scared. This guy was clearly very, very disturbed. And yet he was very neat and orderly. And it's like, it's the kind of thing that, you know, what we found out was what is happening in the world. We've had so many shootings and all this stuff that people are paranoid. People are scared. Really, really paranoid. I think, like, wow, maybe I should go talk to him and say, what is going on? You're kind of scaring everybody. And so, you know, the party's over in America. The fact that we can't even congregate without jitters because if somebody comes in, and there's the whole thing, there were so many weird people. Some came in with ink all over his face, and he's just like, he was deranged, absolutely deranged, and he came right and sat right behind me. And there's other people that came in that people noticed, like, there's some really weird vibe going on, really weird and scary. We thought the guy might have a gun and start shooting everybody, honestly. That's what everyone was thinking. And so it was an extremely nerve-wracking time. So people are coughing, flus everywhere in the church, guys coming in, we think he might be a shooter. So it is not good, all right? This is not the America that I signed up for at all. That's far in our rearview mirror, actually. And we were told that they were off-duty policemen in the church, actually, so there was some security there, but nobody knows that. But still, it's a nerve-wracking thing. That's the second or third time something like that's happened where it's really scary, but this one was really very much frank. So I said, I can't get the flu. And so what do I do? I said, well, okay, my time-tested thing is I push it into the future, say, in the future. Not now. Thanks, but no thanks. Maybe later. And I just said, okay, that works. And then I said, wait a minute, why don't I just push everything into my credit card, as it were? I say, I'll pay it all later. I can push my death there. I can push all sickness there. I can push all fatigue. I can push all unhappiness. I can push everything there. I say, no, I want all those things to flee from me all at once, and it will be on my account, and then I'll have to pay it later. Of course, see, we can do that. We can do that. Actually, that we are capable of doing that. And of course, later, when you realize that this hypothetical contingency plan is totally unnecessary, you realize, I can set the entire thing down, and you never pay it, and never end up never having to pay that debt. But for now, what you have to do is you have to push it all on your credit card, as it were, into the future. Say, I'll pay it later. Right now, I'm going to be perfectly happy, and all the misery that I'm supposed to endure, all the suffering, the dying, the death, the sickness, all these things, I'll pay them all later, all at once. Now, I said, okay, that's great. I said, okay, let's push it all the way all at once. And then I said, uh-oh, wait a minute. Maybe it'll come back and be all at once too. I have to pay it off all at once. And that's like, whoa, maybe I just better keep paying it all this suffering off a little bit at a time. So I was thinking about that at work, and then I suddenly said, no. You know, wow, it's all okay. I saw how it's all okay to pay it off, to push it away all at once like that. And I can't remember the precise insight at this moment, but I had this big breakthrough, and I saw, oh my gosh, it's very doable. Very doable. You see, we are working on a contingency plan. What if a reality were annihilated? So we're modeling this annihilation, and in doing so, we're going through all sorts of sufferings and miseries and fear and threat and dying and being reborn and all this stuff, getting old, getting the flu, everything, as part of the working on the contingency plan. So the ego says, we tell ourselves, hey, we have to go through all this stuff. At some point in time, we're going to have to go through it, so we might as well face up to it now and get it as much done as we can, right, this life. Let's go through all the suffering, the misery, the torment, the sickness, the dying. Let's just get it as much done as possible right now. Don't waste our time. And so the idea is pushing it all into the future seems to be like a really crazy thing to do, because then they'll say, well, you're just going to waste your time being happy now, and then in the future you're going to have to face all that stuff, and it's going to be, you know, you're just postponing the inevitable. Of course, you can always say that the contingency plan is entirely unnecessary, which is true. Therefore, you don't need to come up with any contingency plan. Therefore, you don't need to experience anything at all, including all that suffering that's in the future. So I saw that and said, hey, let it all try to come back all at once. It can't touch me. It cannot touch me, because I'll just push that in the future too, and just keep pushing it all in the future. And you can even let all the sins, all the suffering in the world, let it all come to me, and I can just push it all in the future. No problem whatsoever. It was very clear, very easy. I said, this is crystal clear. And that was just like during I was working, loading stuff. I just saw it. I said, okay. So anytime in your life, you can see this stuff. You don't have to be in a cave. You can see it. It's all seeable. It is all seeable how you can literally be completely happy right now and not have any sickness touch you or death touch you or anything touch you. It is like that. You can do it right now if you understand this, that you push it into the future, and for you realize you don't need any to work on. You don't need to come up with any contingency plan. So all of this is unnecessary, completely unnecessary. But right now, until we see that's completely unnecessary, we can push it into the future. So you just say to the flu bug, you say, look, thanks but no thanks. Because it's really offering you an opportunity to suffer. That's supposed to be very helpful for you. You see, it's like it's an attack on you. And it's like a mini death. And then you survive that death. You say, okay, I'm getting closer to dying and surviving death. So if you say, no thanks to the flu. Thank it for coming and saying, well, thanks for coming, but thanks, but no thanks. Gracias. No gracias. Thanks, but gracias, pero no gracias. Thanks, but no thanks. Adios, goodbye. You just do like that. And the bug cannot get into you. It cannot get into you. You use your mind that way. You can literally use your mind. The power of choice is a choice, not a process. You simply decide you're going to push in the future. And the flu will say, well, you're going to have to get the flu sometime. You might as well do it now. Get it over with. And you say, no, not now. Not now. Maybe later. Tal vez al rato. Later. Maybe later. Just say, maybe later. Maybe later. Say, maybe later. Maybe later. Not now. Maybe later. And you literally can decide that. You can decide not to get sick, actually. You can even decide not to die. You can decide not to suffer at all. You can decide that. You can say, maybe later. Not now, but maybe later. We'll see. You can do that with everything, and you can do it all at once. All at once. Yes, we decide to do it a little bit at a time, because we're afraid we have to pay it off, or somebody have to pay it off all at once, because we got rid of it all at once, the payment will come due all at once. No, because whenever the payment comes due, we just say, no, not now, no thanks, I don't want the sickness now. Maybe later. So that is my immunization shot, is mental, is a mental thing. It's determination, say, no, I'm not accepting any flu bug. Not now. And you can build on that and generalize it, and you can literally send your death packing as well. Say, not now, later. Sickness, infirmity, fatigue, all that stuff, whatever you don't want, you say, not now, later. all suffering. You can do that. If you have the nerve to put it all on your credit card, as it were, and know that you never have to pay it off. You never have to pay it off. So that's the approach I'm taking to the flu. But it does require a lot of clarity, that is for sure. But you can do it. You can do it right now. You can just decide, no, I'm not going to get the flu this year. I'm not going to. I decided not to get it. And that the power of that decision, flu can't touch you, cannot touch you. Should not be able to get in at all. Unless you're waffling, say, well, maybe I better go along and get it. Everybody else is getting it. I might need the immunity, blah, 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 blah. So, tested a vast ocean of insight. So right now, in the very severe difficulties of the world and the people saying, things are going to go really bad, et cetera, et cetera. They are, but you don't have to be touched by them. You do not have to be touched by any of that, actually. You can decide that you're going to be completely unharmed and untouched. Absolutely, that is totally within your decision. And the ego will say, okay, but you're going to have to suffer it later. And you say, well, we'll see. Maybe later. Not now, but maybe later. So you're playing that. You can play that game with the ego pushing us aside. And you don't have to wait for enlightenment to do that. But what you'll find out is, the more you do that, the closer you realize you can push all suffering away, and that is enlightenment, essentially. You can push time away. You can say to time, not now, maybe later. Like as far as seeing things, not seeing the eternal now, not seeing everything overlaid by the eternal now, and time says, hey, you need to see, what if this weren't as it is right now? And you say, well, not right now, maybe later. And so you can push time off as well. You can push all sickness, suffering. You can push time off. All of that stuff. You can push it off that way. Not now, maybe later. that is, you can do that. And then you will find out, that this is enlightenment. And everybody can do that. You can be feeling absolutely perfect right this minute. Dwelling in with awareness of the eternal now, right this second. If you just decide to do that, and the reason why we don't is we're bluffed by the ego saying, well, go ahead, but you're going to have to face, the more you spend time, like the more you spend like that, the more you're going to have to catch up with your suffering later. And so that's the scary part, you see, that we're being bluffed. It's not so difficult. Enlightenment is not difficult. But we're being bluffed, and therein lies the trouble. Therein lies the big trouble. The ego is the great bluffer, the great bully of belief, the great bluffer. It is such a bluffer, and it because it believes what it's saying. It believes what it's saying. It says it thinks it's doing you a favor by informing you, hey, that you've got to, you cannot, you've got to. You're gonna have to pay severely if you do this. And the ego will say, look, the state you're in is so pleasant, you may not want to come out of it for a long time, and therefore you'll be so far behind, and all of this interest will have accrued on all your suffering, and you're going to just have an impossibly suffering time. It's going to be terrible. So the ego tells you, don't do it. It's a big mistake. That's what it says. So, and it seems to be logical, and it seems to be your friend, and it seems to be helping, and it seems to be trying to save you from terrible suffering. But it is not. Because the fact is, you never have to suffer at all. You don't have to suffer at all. You don't need a we don't need a contingency plan for in case reality is destroyed. We don't need to make death real and then survive it. All that is, it will never have any utility at all. So all this suffering is totally useless. It's actually completely useless. And you will see at some point it's completely useless. And at that point, there's no more use for it. You don't have, you won't call any of it to yourself. You won't call death to you and say, hey, death, I need you. I see you're very useful. No, you'll say, death, you're completely useless. Suffering, you're completely useless. Sickness, useless. Scarcity, useless. Unhappiness, useless. All that stuff is totally useless. No use to whatsoever. And then you won't call it to yourself. You won't call it to yourself. You won't. You won't have that hypothetical. You'll exchange hypotheticals. So the flu season is really a great opportunity for your spiritual sadhana, the practice of saying, no, this is useless to me right now. It has no use. I have no use for you now, flu. Maybe later. So it's tough to say never right now, never, because then the ego will say, well, wait a minute, maybe you're going a little nuts here, and it starts working on you. So if you just say, well, no, I have no use for you right now, perhaps later, we'll see. That's very reasonable. See, the ego, what can the ego say there? It just kind of has to sort of back away on that one. So when you're getting into seeing how you can simply push time away, push all suffering away, that's pretty good stuff. That was my day today. That's pretty good stuff. How you can literally, the real inner picture on witnessing here to the death-free realm, witnessing to being able to switch hypotheticals, witnessing to the non-necessity of trying to make death real and survive it, witnessing to all that here. And there is a way to do it. I saw this morning how you do it. And it has to do with not trying to establish any legacy at all. One of the greatest mistakes we make is trying to establish a legacy. The teachers that come in here, showcasing bliss, of the death-free realms, of the hypothetical, of not needing hypotheticals. They showcase that here. They showcase that God is not slightest bit disturbed by our total extreme eccentricity, whimsicality, all this stuff. This crazy dream, God is not the slightest bit upset nor bothered or angry at us. They showcase this. And they're not here to build any legacy whatsoever. None. And that's the greatest help possible. When you see a teacher who's totally unconcerned about their legacy, that is the most profound teaching, helpful teaching that there is, really. Because it has to be fresh. It has to be fresh. Jesus said, don't put new wine into old wineskins. And he was crucified for that. He didn't follow along with the rules and regulations of the Old Testament. And so they said, you can't do these things. It's against our Old Testament rules and laws, Mosaic law. And he said, well, you know, this is a New Testament. I'm bringing a New Testament. So it's fresh. It's fresh. It's fresh. It's fresh. The only teaching that really works is that which is fresh. Right now and fresh. It has to be fresh. Now, when you're primarily concerned with building a legacy, what are you doing? You're primarily concerned with time. You're concerned with time. The fact is that as long as there are those who continue to pursue the forgetfulness of reality, the obscuration of reality, attempt to find a way to survive the annihilation of reality, as long as there are aspects of spirit doing that, reminders will appear in their dream, in their hypothetical, showcasing the way back, the way of remembrance. As long as that, and it'll go on and on and on and on and on. So there'll always be some fresh perspective here being given out, always in this hypothetical, always. Until we're all finally choose remembrance, choose to exchange hypotheticals. So go with what is fresh. Go with what is right now. Go with what is fresh right now. Always, 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 always. And don't worry about any legacy at all. Because as soon as you're trying to build a legacy, you're trying to entrench dogma. And then you're trapping people and saying you should go with what's not fresh. Because your legacy means the future. So what inspired me about Sri Anandamayi Ma, when I saw her, what I recognized very quickly was she had the slightest thought for any legacy whatsoever. Not even gave it the slightest thought. Had zero interest in it. None. I was like, whoa, I felt like I should help her out because has no interest. And I said, wow, I should try to build a legacy for her because people forget her. They will. They've already forgotten her. But she had no pull in that direction whatsoever. Was oblivious to it. Oblivious. And people kept trying to say, well, build you an ashram. They were concerned about her legacy. She said, I have no interest in any of that stuff. It's like, but people are going to forget. Well, not everybody. Because some people notice, wait a minute, she's not totally not interested in legacy whatsoever. Interesting, interesting. And that's actually a profound teaching, because the freshness of the death-free realms is always here right now. The eternal now is always fresh right now. It's always present. So what the need does it have for a legacy? Absolutely none. Absolutely none. This is really the highest kind of teaching. The teachers that come in who are really profoundly interested in building a legacy for themselves, that's bogus. It's bogus. They're not great teachers. And what we have mostly in this world is we're just paying attention to legacy. That's not it. That's not it. You have to pay attention to the reminder that is fresh. Teachers who are right now as fresh is speaking to you directly from fresh from the times that we live in, directly fresh. That is what has the, with no legacy. Don't try to establish any legacy for any teacher whatsoever. And when you give that up, when you give legacy up, you give time up. When you give time up, you yourself are enlightened, you see. And then you present the fresh showcase yourself. And those who see you will then present the fresh showcase also. And that is how it actually works. That is how it actually works. Not by trying to build any legacy. Absolutely not. Everyone that comes and is freed from this delusion, exchanges hypotheticals, drops time, etc., they are perfectly capable of showcasing it. Absolutely. Perfectly capable of it. Fresh. Giving it fresh. Now, those who have no interest in legacy are useful to pay attention to it and get that. But then don't try to establish a legacy on that. But those who have or who are aware certainly pay attention to it. I can still pay attention to Ananda my Ma, her videos, pictures, etc., and get that vibe, get it, and understand. But I don't have to go around trying to establish a legacy for her, which is before I was trying to do that. And now I see that's totally inappropriate, actually. Totally. Totally inappropriate. That's not what she wants at all. What she would want is for me to awaken myself. That's the only thing she wants. She doesn't want me to work on her legacy. Her legacy is helping others awaken. That's it. And give fresh showcasing right now. That's the legacy. That's what the Holy Spirit wants. That's what the grace of God wants. Not trying to establish any legacy in time. What good is a legacy in time where everything fades? Basically, we're choosing between what fades away and what's permanent. At least as permanent as a hypothetical can be. In other words, it's not changing, but eventually we set the hypothetical down too. But we're choosing between a hypothetical that fades and a hypothetical that doesn't fade. Anything you try to do in the hypothetical that fades will fade away. So no matter what kind of legacy you try to establish, it's going to fade. It is going to fade. And how does that remind you of reality? It doesn't remind you in the slightest bit. Whereas those who are not the slightest bit interested in any legacy at all, they're saying to you, look, don't waste your time trying to establish a legacy here for me, for you, for anyone. It'll all fade away. It'll all fade away. Instead, wake up, exchange hypotheticals, showcase bliss here, showcase it. And then that will help many also wake up, and they will showcase it too. Don't try to establish a legacy for yourself. That literally frees you. It frees you from existence if you can get that. And I was able to work through it this morning and see all of it. All of it. I saw it. And I saw how I came back into this world partly to work on my own legacy, because I had established something previously and I wanted to improve upon it and try to build a legacy here. And that was a drastic mistake. And when someone sees someone like Nana Mai, you look at her and say, why are you unconcerned about your legacy? You know, you leave here and you just as soon have no legacy at all. It's like, wow, that's kind of strange. What's going on? But at least you see it and you say, huh, why, what's that about? And then I said, oh, hey, let me build a legacy for you. I'll do that for you. And that got me into heaps of trouble, actually. Because what happens when you're really willing to build a legacy for someone, that's where the ego jumps you and says, hey, you can build a legacy for the ego. And it will showcase the ego as some very seemingly spiritual entity or something. And then you're supposed to work to help build their legacy. But the real teachers don't ask anyone to build a legacy for them. Absolutely not. And they don't ask any of the devotees to build a legacy for themselves either. They say, no. That's not it. So if you can get insight into this, you are literally at the, crossing the threshold into enlightenment, actually. Because you simply then showcase that to people. No legacy. The real world doesn't need any legacy in the realm that fades. How could it possibly have a legacy there? Everything fades here. What kind of fake? It would be a fake legacy. You can't get the clear feeling of the freshness of the death-free realm through any legacy here in this world. You can't get it through the legacy of Jesus, legacy of Buddha, legacy of anyone. Absolutely cannot. I go to church, and am I getting something fresh right now, direct? Not at all. I'm getting a legacy, just a legacy, and it's stale, and it's rotten, and it's decayed, and it's falling apart. And there's nothing, and it's nothing there that can remind me of reality at all. No way. Legacy. Stay away from legacies altogether. Altogether. And that is what I'm heading toward. That's what I saw this morning. I said, yeah, I'm down with that. I understand it. Which is a huge thing. Drop the legacies of everything. Nobody needs a legacy of all. Does the eternal now need a legacy? How could it need a legacy? It's always now. It's always fresh. Freshness doesn't need a legacy. So those great teachers show us reality doesn't need a legacy. Stop trying to build a legacy for reality. Stop trying to build a legacy. You don't need to do it. Drop it. And in dropping it, others will see that too and say, hey, they realize, hey, I can drop it too. And others will see them and say, hey, we can drop it too. And you get this wonderful domino effect of more and more saying, hey, we don't need to keep working on any sort of legacy. Forget it. It doesn't matter who was enlightened in the past or who will be enlightened in the future. We'll all be enlightened. So who cares about any legacy? It's completely nuts. For what purpose? We'll all be enlightened. Equally, everyone. We already know the legacy. We'll all be enlightened. It doesn't matter who goes first, who goes last. Makes no difference. And the way is clear. The way is simple. The Holy Spirit's always with everyone now. The eternal now is here. Everything is in place. Will always be in place. You don't need to. All you need to do is accept it. And others will see that you've accepted. And then they'll accept it. Others will see them. And that's just how it goes. It's just like that. Just like that. The worst thing possible is trying to live off a legacy. You don't need to talk really much about any teachers at all, actually. A little bit. Recent teachers can be helpful. A little bit. But you have to get it yourself. It's you. It's me. It's you. It's us right now. That's all that matters right now, is right now. And where we're at right now, it doesn't matter who woke up in the past or who will wake up in the future. That's not our concern. It's not our concern at all. It's us waking up right now that's our concern. And you do that through fresh presentation right now. And realizing you won't have a legacy. You will not have a spiritual legacy in the realm where everything fades. Well, how could you? And why would you want legacy there? That's ridiculous. You'd only have a legacy that fades. Look at Jesus' legacy in this world. My gosh, how terrible, isn't it? my gosh, the legacy they claim for him is someone who believes that sacrifice is the answer, salvation, which is exactly opposite of what he teaches and what is true. That's not his legacy. But some people are trying to build a legacy for him. They said, gee, he didn't leave any legacy here. We better build one for him. No, that's not what he wants. Absolutely not. You spend all the time building a legacy, you waste all that time. It's a totally eccentric use of time. You should use that time to see through the very clearly what the situation is here. Exchange hypotheticals. You should use the time for that, not trying to build someone's legacy. Jesus doesn't need a legacy. He's already free. We don't need a legacy. All we need is to be free. Is to remember reality. Is to deal with the continuity problem. That's all we need to do. And then that's it. So what's a legacy? All we need is to deal with the continuity problem. Legacy has nothing to do with that. It's kind of a false use of legacy. I mean, false use of continuity issue. False use of it. Like, yeah, the church has been here for 2,000 years. How does that solve the continuity problem? It says, well, it's been continuous for 2,000 years. That has nothing to do with reminding us of reality. Because everything in it is fade, 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 fade. That's a level of confusion. That's like saying you can remember reality by remaining insane for a long time. Say, well, I've been continuously insane, so that must remind me of reality. No, the continuity problem is not just anything being continuous. It means experiencing, hypothetically experiencing, that which is very similar to reality. And this world here has no similarity to whatsoever. The world where everything is impermanent, there's no similarity whatsoever. So you can say, well, I've been continuously experiencing what has no similarity whatsoever for a billion years. That doesn't solve the continuity problem. If the ego is such a crazy advisor, it tells you that it will. It's just all you have to do is just keep sticking with whatever you're doing, and that'll solve the continuity problem. No, it won't. That's like saying you're super dying of thirst. You say, well, I haven't had a drink in 10 days, so if I do another 10 days, that should solve my thirst problem. That's literally how the ego, that's the kind of advice the ego gives you, really. Actually, it's more sneaky about it, but that's what it does. How does that solve the thirst problem? It doesn't at all. So, we have to make certain choices to choose to have the continuity problem resolved for us, which means experiencing that which doesn't fade away, which we don't want to change, is immaculate, is perfect just as it is, and that reminds us of reality. That's the only way to do it. I don't know what tomorrow will bring. Every day is bringing gargantuan, huge, huge progress for me right now. I could be enlightened tomorrow. That's possible. Very possible. Very possible, actually. I'm sort of like teetering on, you know, on the brink of going past the threshold of that, all that, really. But then again, you know, you can also get stuck in a trap. That is possible too. Doesn't seem very likely at this point, but it is possible. Because there's no wisdom in the ego at all. As soon as you turn that direction, you it's a free fall. It is a free fall. Really, literally free fall. And you can just say, I don't need this free fall. There's no reason for this free fall. And it's the ability to see it as a free fall. That is what is profound. That is what's actually helpful, is to see just how terrible it is. And then you say, I don't want that. That's not useful. It's not useful. And you can pray. If you're getting stuck, just pray. Say, I want only what is useful. And I want to let go of everything that's useless to me. I want to do that right now. Right now. Just make these positive, affirmative prayers, and that'll dial you in. It'll connect you to clarity, and then you'll be able to see, wow, this whole world is like in a complete free fall, constantly. And I don't need that. That's useless to me. It doesn't remind me of reality. No necessity to it whatsoever. No necessity to this free fall. And then you'll come out of the free fall into what is not falling at all. So don't be afraid of seeing it as it really is, how terrible it is, what we've been engaged with, because that all that does is motivate you to let go of it. Of course, you have to know what to let go of, what you're letting go of and for. But again, when you get into that deep territory, just say, good, this is where I want to be. I want to see this. Don't panic. Don't freak out. Don't say, oh my gosh, this is scary or something. No, 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 no. Bring it on. Bring it on. Bring it on. This is exactly what I want. And be eager to see how terrible it really is. If you do, you'll feel a sense of profound progress, actually. Don't let the ego tell you how bad it is. Because it won't reveal how terrible it really is. It will try to sidetrack you on something, some sob story. No. It's a profound. See the profundity of it. How we're doing nothing but wasting our time. We're completely eccentric. Every thought we have, all the thinking we're doing is totally unnecessary. We can have quiet mind right now. Oh, I also thought about pushing all thoughts. When I talk about pushing everything in the future, all the sickness, I also realize I can push all thinking, all thoughts into the future, as it were. Say, not now, maybe later, but I don't need any thoughts right now. Don't need any thinking, any thoughts. And I got very close to quiet mind, very close today. All this in one day. So I'm telling you, this is very possible. You know, this is something just in the day of life. What is it, January 29th? Just this January 29th, 2013. All of this came in one day as I went about my work. Just driving and doing what I do. And just notice, hey, I can have quiet mind right now, as a matter of fact. I don't need any thinking. I don't need these thoughts. I don't need I thoughts. I don't need the thoughts of I. Don't need any of those thoughts. The thoughts of, well, I need something to survive the destruction of what is. So this I and all its thinking is the process of doing that. Don't need that. Maybe later. Don't need it now at all. Don't need it now at all. And I can saw how that can be pushed aside. It can be pushed aside. Time can be pushed aside. All of this hypothetical contingency plan can be pushed aside. You don't need to say future, just later, not now. Some other point, not now. And then I thought, how would it be to, well, I didn't think, but I kind of felt, how would it be to have no thoughts? So I spent a lot of time today sort of real close to this no thought condition. I said, well, this would be very useful. Very useful and very non-eccentric. So that's fine. And this is along the lines of what people call enlightenment. Still mind, the empty mind, no thoughts in the mind, so to speak. That empty mind, empty mindness is along the lines of enlightenment. It's certainly a strong, strong step in that direction. That is for sure. And I felt super close to that today. And not just sort of luckily, like a glimpse or anything. No, I mean, actually very clear about what it's all about. Very clear about it. And just say, hey, that's easy. That's easy. It's not difficult. That's not so difficult. It's just a simply seeing a situation and it's, oh, yeah, I can do that. So I don't know, when you're in an empty mind, your mind is empty, then... well, what happens next? I don't know. You're still aware. You just don't need any I thoughts. You realize the non-necessity of any I thoughts. And that's certainly very doable. Okay. Now, is that the complete end game of enlightenment and what we're going towards? You know, we'll see. But is certainly a great step in the right direction, and that is definitely doable, okay? I saw today, what I saw was for you, for me, it's really doable. It absolutely is doable. It's not too difficult. We can't get to the point, so we don't need any I thoughts. We don't need any I thoughts at all. And without any I thoughts, you can dwell in the eternal now, the overlay, as it were, the beauty of the staging here, we'll see, so beautiful. All of that is very possible because you don't need any I thoughts. I thoughts are, what if it weren't? What if it weren't beautiful? What if it weren't permanent? What if it weren't? We don't need those thoughts. They're not necessary. So we can literally push those thoughts aside and say, there's no more necessity to those. And just decide. It's just a decision. And just decide. For me, so I decide I don't need those. And so that's it. No more. No more necessity to them. And they'll vanish. They'll vanish. So all the efforts on the spiritual path, everything, it is doable. It is really doable. And so we must do it. We must do it. Don't spend our time worrying about legacies. We must do it now. We must be the ones that do it. We are the ones that we've been waiting for. We are the ones that must do it. And we are the ones that must do it now. And we are the ones that will do it now. And we're not concerned about any legacy. We're just concerned about doing it now. We're just concerned about quiet mind, empty mind, doing that now. And the mind isn't really empty. It's just there's no I thoughts arising. That's all. It's actually full. You actually realize full mind. It's not empty mind. It's full mind. Because the I thoughts are saying, well, what if mind weren't full? What would we do then? So it's really full mind. It's not empty mind at all. It's just they say, well, it's empty of I thoughts. But that actually then, it's like saying the sky is empty of clouds. Was the sky empty then? No, it's a full sky. You see the majesty of the full sky instead of it being obscured by clouds. When there's heavy fog, how far can you see? You can't hardly see any sky at all. When all the fog is gone, what do you see? You see the totality of the sky, don't you? You can see all the space and everything. And it's just like, wow. So it's full mind, not empty mind. And that is totally doable for us. I will certainly do it at some point. I will do it. You will do it. We will all do it. Why not now? Why not get it done now? It's a great time to get it done now. So, I keep you updated. I try to keep you updated. The progress is so fast. I can't hardly put it all together in a video. Really, I tried. I got most of it in here. Yeah. But we need to go fast now because the deterioration is also very fast now. It's super fast. The I thoughts are getting very, very intense, and more and more and more I thoughts, more and more self-deception, more and more belief in the necessity of the I and its path to death and surviving death, death and resurrection. That's the whole path of the I. The I needs to die and then to be resurrected from the dead. And that will then solve the contingency plan, and we think everything will be fine then, except this is all just a ridiculous fantasy that doesn't remind us of reality at all. So it's useless. So is enlightenment on its way? In my case, yeah, absolutely, it's on its way. It's on its way in everyone's case. In my case, I'm aware that it's you know, knocking at the door, so to speak. Certainly, the question, am I aware that these insights are crucial? Absolutely. Absolutely aware that these are crucial insights that I'm having. Central. Absolutely central. And it's almost like the sky is clearing. Very much clearing up. Rapidly clearing. Yeah, it's really like the fog is burning off. And it's burning off really fast now. And because there's a certain point where the momentum suddenly becomes very quick, very fast. The Holy Spirit said it would make my head spin. The progress is going to become so fast now, it's going to make my head spin. And it's almost doing that. So it's a figure of speech, but it is super fast right now. But I feel fine. I feel fine. All the problems of the world are still there. It's causing, you know, pulling at me severely. But quiet mind will certainly be a great step forward, to say the least. No sickness, great step forward. No troubles, no harm, no suffering, great step forward. Ultimately, dwelling in the death-free realm is how I see it. But here, in this world, these are great, great steps forward. Very significant steps forward. So, at some point, this will all come to pass at some point. For me, for you, for all of us. Sooner is better than later, for sure. So, before I freeze out here, we could use some warmer weather. It's supposed to be a few couple days coming up, a little warmer. I know the rest of people, so many people in the world now are really, really, really cold. It's just, wow. What do you do? It's not easy. It's not pleasant. And again, the world is going into... I was reading A Course in Miracles today, and Jesus said, self-deception inevitably leads to conflict. Inevitably. He says there's no escape from it. And we're engaging in massive self-deception in the world right now. So massive. Jesus said, honesty is the key. Which is, I echo that. Absolutely, I've always said that. Honesty is the key. Just saying, am I being eccentric now? Am I making eccentric use of time now? Be honest with yourself, and you'll find that's the greatest gift you can give yourself is just self-honesty. And when you give yourself that honesty, you don't feel any need for conflict. But those who are deeply into self-deception, they're feeling a tremendous need for conflict now. And that will accelerate and accelerate and accelerate. And Jesus said it's unavoidable. Conflict's unavoidable for those who are engaged in self-deception. In other words, so what do you think is going to happen in the world? I mean, the self-deception in the world is off the scale. I don't think you can build a scale to even measure it. So what kind of conflict is going to come from that? It's also going to be off the scale, hard to measure. So certainly we want to push all our suffering to the side, say not now, maybe later, and have that capability right now. We must, it's so important. So we will do that. We will absolutely do that. And again, I don't know what my progress is going to be like, but I'm going to stay with it. So it should be what you would expect. The momentum should increase even more. And so I just go with that, and it's all great. It's all great. So stick with it. See, if you can, keep watching. It gets better. I always have said the best is yet to come, and that is very true. The best is yet to come, and it's going to be, when it comes, it's going to be quite, quite fresh. Quite fresh. I have that freshness. I'm not tied to any legacy. I'm not tied down to any legacy at all. And it feels to me, it feels right now, right fresh, in the moment. All of that, and that's what it has to be. It has to be that way. I don't feel like I need to sit down and read the Bhagavad Gita to people, or the Bible, or even A Course in Miracles, or anything like that. No. This feels way more fresh than that. It feels immediate. It feels right now. It feels totally, totally fresh right now. And that is what really, really is something that you feel. You feel the freshness of it. That is profound. You can read the Bhagavad Gita from now until doomsday, but if you get a moment of fresh truth, that is what makes the impact on you. It reaches something within you. And you say, hey, this is here now. This is here right now. It's not a legacy. This is here right now. This condition is here right now. It is possible right this minute. It is here now. And that makes a great, great impression. So that is what our aim is. That is what our aim is. Very great. That's it for this video. And we'll keep on going. Okay.